How's it going, everyone, and welcome to another Flesh and Blood video here on Channel Fireball. Today, we're going to talk about Tales of Aria Limited. I'm going to give you my experiences at the Aria world premiere event at the Las Vegas Calling. My name is Kellen, and I run the YouTube channel Red Zone Rogue. I also did commentary for the Vegas event, and I'm just going to talk about my experiences actually playing the game here. If you want to hear my experiences with the event overall and basically what I have to just say about my time in Vegas, I do have videos talking about that up on Red Zone Rogue, and you know, go ahead and check that out. But today, I want to talk about some cards. These are actually some of the promos that came with the Channel Fireball bundles. Look at this awesome looking foil librarian. We also got these cold foil promos. This is the Amulet of Earth. We have some more amulets in here. I'll talk about a little bit. I didn't have a ton of experience playing Ulduum, but I did play Lexi, and I also played with Briar. I think Briar's actually on one of these tokens here. We'll pull Briar up. I think she's on the back of this Frostbite token. So I initially played in the Aria event with Briar because my pool had a bunch of cards that deal arcane damage, and there's no way to block arcane damage in Tales of Aria except for a legendary card. And by block, I mean prevent the arcane damage. It's called Heart of Ice, and it has Arcane Barrier 1. There's another card that has Spell Void. I believe it's the Shock Charmers has Spell Void, but that's not a reliable way to prevent it. And so Briar is actually a pretty easy way to get some free wins if you have a lot of arcane damage. The Rosetta Thorn does arcane damage on it naturally if you've played an attack action and a non-attack action. So it's just a good way to just deal a whole bunch of chip damage. But I don't think it's overpowered because some of the other heroes, and by some of the other ones, I mean both of them, Lexi and Ulduum, hit like trucks. And it's kind of like a give and take. I think all three of the heroes are quite good. But I'll talk to you about Briar really, really quickly. Some of the key cards that I thought were absolutely fantastic. I really liked getting the Sutcliffe's Suede Hides. Being able to get go again on an attack action is just absolutely fantastic. You have to have played a non-attack action first. And in Sealed, it's just gonna come down to your pool. I only have like 6 non-attack actions in my deck. So this wasn't always turned on. It was actually pretty difficult to do, but when I could do it, just being able to get go again and possibly throw in the Rosetta Thorn for an extra 2 damage plus 2 arcane damage, it's just good. It's just really, really good. And when, you know, you're playing limited and you're playing with these young heroes and only have 20 health, 2 damage is 1/10 of your opponent's life. Not too bad. Ragamuffin's Hat, not good. I don't know, man. I don't think this card is good at all. You have to have one card in your hand to activate it. I think I did it once and it literally didn't change anything. And let's just go over some of the cards. Overall, I found that it's really difficult to fuse stuff in Sealed because your pool is gonna be kind of mixed between whatever elements you wanna do. So like this one is an elemental ranger action, it has lightning fusion. The chances that you have a ton of lightning cards is fairly slim. You're probably gonna have pretty close to even lightning, ice, and earth. And because of that, well, you know, a third to a half of your deck is gonna be, you know, one or the other. It's gonna be really hard to focus on just one. I think if you can, I think it's better to focus on just one because I found it really hard to do the fusions. Maybe it was just my pool, but I just found it really, really hard to do the fusions. Basically what I did is I tried to cut one as much as I could, but once again, it's still really hard. After I put my pool together, and let me just kind of show you what we had here for some of the Runeblade cards. After I put my pool together, I really only had like, I don't know, like 6 cuts to make. So after choosing your hero, you don't have a lot of options for cuts basically, because I ended up with a pool of maybe 36 to 39 playable cards. And then after that, you cut cards that you literally can't play, like this one, Inspire Lightning. It is a 1 cost card. It's a non-attack action, box for 2, has lightning fusion. And if you fused it, it does 3 arcane damage to a hero. That's pretty good. However, if you don't have a lot of lightning cards, this does literally nothing and blocks for 2. So it doesn't pitch well, blocks poorly, and doesn't do anything if you don't have any lightning. And I ended up with 3 of these. So I'm like, I can't play these. So I had to cut all of these because I had like, what, 5 lightning cards out of a 30 card deck. that is not a gamble that I was willing to make. So the sealed building part actually wasn't that bad. And to be completely honest, we didn't have a ton of time to build. We had a decent amount of time, but we saw so many new cards, which was really, really exciting, by the way. I love how Legend Story Studios doesn't preview the whole set, so there's some discovery here. But there's a lot of reading, right? And they're like, you have 5 minutes. And I'm like, I don't know. I didn't read all the cards. These all have arcane damage. There's no arcane barrier in the set. Put all the arcane damage cards in there. And speaking of which, let's pull out all of the arcane damage cards, because these cards are were absolutely fantastic. I think they were like the cornerstone of the deck, and I'm pretty lucky that I got a decent number of them, which is why I went for Runeblade anyway. And I think that's like the real strength of it. Also, this is just an Earth card, but a 2-cost Earth card that gives your next attack action +5 in Limited, that is quite good. That is very hard to block. So, especially if you are playing a class that has like some sort of big heavy hitters like Dominate or something, I think this could be disgusting in Ulduum. But these cards are the ones I want to talk about, because they are both at common and rare. The Sigil of Suffering here is at rare, and this card is absolutely fantastic. It costs 0 to play, is a defense reaction, blocks natively for 3, and it says, deal 1 arcane damage to the attacking hero. I literally killed someone with this. If you have dealt arcane damage this turn, it gains +1 defense. And guess what? It's going to deal arcane damage this turn, so it basically blocks for 4. So you immediately play it, does 1 arcane damage to your opponent. They can choose to, you know, prevent it if they have arcane barrier, and then it's blocking for 4. Absolutely fantastic. And I got a couple of these. So they just kind of go down in defense. So the yellow blocks for 2, and the blue blocks for 1. But still, really good. Definitely worth running. Just that extra arcane damage really gets there. Bramble Spark is another one that I don't think was spoiled. It's a 0-cost card, blocks for 2. It's an elemental Runeblade action, has Earth Fusion. And it says, the next attack action card you play this turn gains. When you attack with this, deal 1 arcane damage to target hero. So it's just another card you want to play, and then play a you want to play an attack action. And if you can get that one go again, you can immediately follow that up with the Rosetta Thorn, which also deals arcane damage. So you can chain together really disgusting turns where you just deal a lot of unblockable damage, which is quite good. It also says if it was fused, the next attack action card you play this turn gains +1. For the yellow, it's +2. For the red, it's +3. But either way, a 0-cost card that pumps up your stuff is really good. I think this is going to be a very key card for the Briar Limited strategy, especially in draft, because it's common. Another really, really key card is the Singeing Steel Blade. 1-cost card, comes in for 4 for the red pitch, blocks for 3. That's pretty good. There's not a lot of cards that block for 3 in this set. There's a lot of block 2s. So blocking for 3 is pretty good. But you don't want to block with this. You want to attack with it, because it says, when you attack with Singeing Steel Blade, deal 1 arcane damage to target hero. Once again, just guaranteed damage, and coming in for 4, really, really good break point there, where you're going to have to force them to block with at least 2 cards from their hand. This is an all-star. It's a common card. Draft as much of these as you can if you're playing Runeblade. It's amazing. And then another one, not quite as good as the Singeing Steel Blade, but still pretty good. This is the Arcanic Shockwave. It's a 0-cost, 3 defense, 4 attack for the red pitch, and it has Lightning Fusion. And if you would attack with it, if you fused it, it deals 1 arcane damage to target hero. So it's basically a Singeing Steel Blade that costs less, but you have to Lightning Fuse. I would say probably try to lean more in on the Lightning Fusion for this kind of Briar strategy. And maybe you'll have a couple Earth cards here and there to activate your Bramble Spark. But to be completely honest, this is really where you want to be. They're both commons, and I think they're going to be a huge part of the Limited metagame. Just absolutely fantastic stuff. I have a little bit of experience playing with Lexi, and we'll talk about that really, really quickly. I mostly played with Briar. I got a bunch of basically free wins with Briar just because of the arcane damage. But Lexi is great. There's not a lot of ways to actually use her once per turn action, and that's just because there's not very many cards with reload that put cards face down in your arsenal, other than just, you know, arsenaling at end of turn. However, Shiver is really, really good. Getting +1 or dominate is amazing. Basically, depending on what your opponent's doing, you almost always want to dominate if you can come in for 4 or more damage, because that basically means that you get some free damage in, and that's really where you want to be in limited. You want to get that free guaranteed damage in, and a lot of the cards in here are going to be coming in for 4 or more. You know, we have your, by the way, it has to be an arrow, you know, it is a bow, so the activation does have to be an arrow. Getting plus 1 is not bad, especially on a card like Bolt and Shot, because if its attack value is greater than its base, it has go again, and if it hits, it gets reload, so that's pretty good coming in for 5. But a lot of the times, you just want to dominate your stuff like your Frazzles, you know, couple that with some of the really, really good Weave cards that give you some pluses. I've had a lot of really good turns where it's just like Weave Ice into like red Blizzard Bolt. So it's just like, you know, it's a 7 attack card with Dominate, and if it hits, they get a Frostbite token. That's really good. I think the Weave cards are really great in a Lexi deck where you just want to dominate a bunch of arrows like the Blizzard Bolt. And the Blizzard Bolt, you know, is really good. A 1 cost 5 attack card, once again, blocks for 3. I think a lot of the Lexi ones that I gravitated towards were the ice cards, but I really do think some of the lightning cards would be great as well. And as you can see, there's basically just kind of like almost like a 50-50 breakdown in the deck. I just, you know, chose one and then leaned more heavily into that. And for my pool at least, I think the ice cards were the ones. Though, yeah, there's some pretty decent lightning ones. Cards like Electrify are also fantastic, because if it's played from the arsenal, you get a draw card. So it's kind of like a Plunder Run. Not really, but kind of like a Plunder Run. And a lot of there's a bunch of on-hit effects here. So it's like the next time an attack action card hits a hero this turn, it deals 3 damage to them. So if you're dominating your arrows, it's really hard to block. That's just an extra 3 damage you can deal to them. So really like Electrify here as well, especially in like a dominate style strategy. Yeah, it's just really good stuff. And I think for Lexi, that's where you want to go. I'm not sure how easy it is going to be to go wide. There are some go wide cards like this one right here, Ball Lightning, and Lexi's not the only one that can use this. Briar can use this card too, because it's a lightning card. It's a 0 cost card, has 0 defense, which is very, very interesting. Comes in for 3, and it says, whenever a lightning or elemental action card would deal damage to this combat chain, instead it deals that much plus 1 go again, which includes itself, because it itself is a lightning card. It doesn't say whenever another, it just says whenever A, so counts itself. So 0 cost, coming in for 3 with go again with a pretty good effect. This card is great at common. Card's great. You have to be careful though. Blocks for 0. I learned that the hard way. I really, really like the Blizzard Bolt, and I really like the Chilling Ice Vein. Both of them I think are fantastic. Being able to dominate Chilling Ice Vein and forcing them to discard a card unless they pay some resources is really good. It's quite good. I really like the Lightning Press. It's just a rare card, but I think it's quite good. This is the yellow version. It's a 0 cost lightning instant, and an attack action with cost 1 or less gains plus 2. The red one is plus 3 at instant speed. It's basically like a instant speed Razor Reflex for 0. Yeah, it's sweet. The Lightning Press, which is a play, by the way, play on words on Lunging Press. It's quite good. I think you kind of want to minimize a lot of your class cards, which makes sense why there's not a lot in the card pool. Just because they don't synergize with anything. And, you know, it's just a ranger card, so it doesn't synergize with any of your fusions. And you really want to have like equal part elemental cards and fusion. One thing I learned that I didn't immediately recognize is that cards, for the most part, are either elemental cards with fusions or those types of elemental cards, like a lightning card. So, for example, we have Buzzbolt. It's an elemental card that has lightning fusion, does not count as a lightning card. Whereas Ball Lightning is just a lightning card, does not count as an elemental card, it's just a lightning card. And you want a good mix of these, right? I'm not sure what the exact ratio is. You probably want more of the raw types than cards that care about them, just because. But, you know, it doesn't feel great being able to shoot one of these off and then not have the fusion. Is basically what I'm trying to say. It's just a 1 cost 4 attack. And you want to get the fusion. But most of the elemental cards block pretty well. So there's some give or take there. Anyway, yeah, those are my raw takes. after the Tales of Aria world premiere event. I think it's a ton of fun, an absolute freaking blast to play. I cannot wait to play in my pre-release this weekend. You should play in your pre-release this weekend, or if this is coming out after that, maybe hopefully you've already played in it. And you know, go to some events, play some sealed, play some draft. It's an absolute blast to play. If you're curious about Oldham, I didn't have a good Oldham pool, so I didn't play Oldham. I played against a lot of Oldhams, and honestly, I was able to fatigue them with Briar. I fatigued Oldham with Briar and just killed him with arcane damage. The one thing to note is I had a couple Oldhams try to use their defense reaction ability to prevent 2 damage, to prevent some of the arcane damage coming in from stuff like this. You can't do that. Just so you know, you can't do that. You can't use a defense reaction to prevent this damage, because this damage happens before you even commit cards to block from your hand. In which case, that happens before you even get to the reaction step. So keep that in mind. You cannot prevent the arcane damage from something like Singeing Steelblade, because it has already happened by the time you get to the defense reaction step. Same with Rosetta Thorn, same with the Arcanic Shockwave. You cannot use that defense reaction to prevent any of this arcane damage. Anyway, I think that's gonna do it for today's video. Thank you so much for watching here on Channel Fireball. My name is Kellen. I run the YouTube channel Red Zone Rogue. And like I said, I did coverage for the Las Vegas Calling event. Definitely go check out that live stream VOD. It was a lot of fun. And the top 8 was really, really exciting, especially the last 2 games. If you're looking to pick up some Tales of Aria First Edition, or maybe even the Channel Fireball Bundle, definitely go use the code ROGUE at checkout, and it goes and supports me, and I greatly, greatly appreciate it. But regardless of what you do, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time here on Channel Fireball for some more Flesh and Blood content. Have a good one, all, and we'll see you later. Man, I'm so excited for Aria. This is such a fun set. Yeah, see you later.